name. Let's give him glory where we are. Come on. Let's move in our place. Come on, we love you, Jesus, Lord. Oh, we love you. Come on, just stand where you are, online family as well. Come on. We give you glory. I love it. So I'm dancing in that. Places of defeat, and I'm walking on dry bones. Death has no hold on me, and I'm standing in the fire, but I can't feel the heat. In the middle of the battle, I sing for victory, because I know. If it's under your feet, then it's under mine too. Everything bows to Jesus.
If it's under your feet, then it's under mine too.
Everything,
everything,
everything
bows, to,
bows
Jesus.
To Jesus.
If it's under your feet, then it's under mine too. Everything bows
come on,
to Jesus.
Just lift it up.
If it's under your feet.
Come. still so much more to see. Wherever you go, I'll follow. Come on, here we go.
And gone are the chains that were holding me. And God is the person I used to be. And free from the fear by your perfect love. This is my exodus. This is my exodus.
Come on.
And gone are the chains that were holding me. God is the person I used to be. Free from the fear by your perfect love. This is my exodus. This is my exodus.
This freedom looks good on. Freedom looks good on. Come on, just turn to your neighbor. This freedom looks good on. Freedom looks good on. Come on, tell them.
This freedom looks good on. Freedom looks
come on.
Good on.
Freedom, freedom.
This freedom looks good on.
Hey,
freedom looks good on.
This freedom, this freedom.
This freedom looks good on.
Freedom
looks good on.
This freedom.
This freedom looks good on. Freedom looks good on you.
Hey,
this freedom looks good on. Freedom looks good on.
It looks good on you.
This freedom looks good on. Freedom looks good on.
Hey, come on.
Oh, 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 oh.
In that freedom, and your miracles are happening right now. God, glory, fill the room. This is what He is. You're the same God today, and the same God tomorrow. So help me see the victory you already see. Let my faith be today what it will be tomorrow. When I've seen the victory you already see. Oh, Jesus, I believe. Oh, I love this. Oh, Jesus,
we need a miracle. You are the miracle maker.
Power
your name and all of your glory.
maybe this is you. In the healing, you get the glory. Yeah. In the breaking, you get the glory. Break it all for me. In the breakthrough, you get the glory. Oh, it's ever giving.
In the waiting, you get the glory.
Get the glory, give him the glory.
In the healing,
hands on the healing,
glory.
Oh, my body, oh.
In the breaking,
break
you get the glory.
All for me, all for me.
In the breakthrough, you get the glory.
You get the glory.
You get the glory.
Circumstance. Father, we've come to glorify you this morning. We've come to magnify you this morning. We are devoted to you. Father, we thank you for your presence here with us today, whether we're in person or whether we're online. There's no time or distance in the realm of the Spirit. We've come with hearts of expectation, Father God, the breeding ground for miracles, Lord. Our faith, Father, is in you. Our trust is in you. Our hope is in you, in the name of Jesus. Father, we thank you that as we gather as a church family, Lord, we lift up our military, we lift up our armed forces, our first responders. Father, we thank you, Lord, for the men and the women, Father, who continue to fight the good fight of faith, who continue to press, Father, so that we can walk free in you, Father. We thank you, Lord, for your blood hedge of protection that surrounds them. We declare no weapon formed against them shall prosper in the mighty name of Jesus. And Lord, we lift up our great nation, the United States of America. We declare by faith that we are a nation under your covering, under your hand of protection. We are a nation of righteousness. We stand in righteousness in the name of Jesus. We lift up our president, our vice president, all of those in authority and positions to make decisions. We declare that this is their year of salvation. We declare that everything they do pleases you and gives you glory. That is our testimony. So, Father, we praise you this morning. We honor you, and we just give a shout to say, Jesus, Jesus, we love you, Jesus. We're devoted to you, Jesus. And everyone in agreement says, amen, amen. Welcome, welcome. 9 a.m. service. Before you're seated, go ahead and high five your neighbor, air high five your neighbor, elbow your air elbow your neighbor, look at them in the eye through that mask. That's right, smile. Look at them through the eye and say, God's glory is all over you. Turn to your other neighbor and say, you are devoted to God. That's right. And for those of you online, welcome, welcome. My name is Calvena Sautia. I'm one of the leaders here. And on behalf of our senior pastors, Pastor Art, Pastor Kuna, thank you so much for joining us. Go ahead, if you're online, hit us up in the chat box. Let us know where you're tuning in from. Let us know, let us know if this is your very first time joining us. We'd love to connect with you. We'd love to, you know, we have leaders online that would love to greet you. And whether you're joining us here in Hawaii, whether you're on the mainland, whether you're from another nation. Pastor Kuna was telling me, oh my gosh, I'm gonna get it wrong. She can correct me later on, but like almost 80 nations, I believe it was, right? 78, was that the number? Pastor Coley, yes. Almost 80 nations. Come on, we can do better than that. Let's give God glory. Almost 80 nations were with us this weekend for the devoted 2021 International. That's why it's called International. Nations impacted by the Word of God this weekend. 44 states plus the District of Columbia were tuned in this weekend for our Women's International Devoted Conference. And men, you showed up to the right place. That's right, because we are in the overflow. We are still encountering God. We are faith-filled women and men of faith-filled influence called to make a difference for the kingdom of God here in Hawaii as well as throughout the world. So thank you for tuning in. 7 a.m. We were blessed to have an amazing service. We have different speakers here at the 9. There are going to be different speakers at the 11. And then again, 6 p.m. Yes, we're in person today at 6 p.m. So you are not going to want to miss it. You know, coming up, besides today, coming up next week, Saturday, say next week, Saturday. Next week, Saturday, we have our Generation One service. Come on, the young and the younger. We're going to be gathering here at 5 p.m. because we are united to make a difference in our schools, in our colleges, our university, in the workplace. So invite those, you know, of that Generation One, high school, young adults, and their families. Bring them all in, because we're ministering to the families. It's about the generational blessing that God has deposited in the house of God and in our families. So come join us next week, Saturday. And speaking of our devoted, as you can see, I have some things in my hand. We have a boutique outside. We have these amazing different, I just grabbed one. I wanted to grab them all. I literally grabbed a bunch and bought it and took it home. All the ones I have are pink. But we have these amazing mugs that you can get, whether for water or coffee or tea or whatever, juice, whatever you want to put in there. But it's just a reminder that we're devoted to God. And Pastor Kuna has these sayings. We love her sayings. And that's what was printed over these tumblers here. And then as well as these tote bags. We still have a few more tote bags left. So you're going to want to get your hands on these tote bags. Pastor Kuna signed every single tote bag. You can see her signature there at the bottom. This one says, if we do the surrender, God will do the amazing. Come on. Can you see yourself going to the grocery store, looking, and then the girl handing it like, wow, this is really cool. Do you have a church? Do you go to church? I mean, you know, it's just a conversation piece to invite people to church, right? So get a hold of one. Christmas shopping, never too early, right? Christmas shopping, or just because. My husband blesses me just because. Men, hint, hint. Just because shopping, right? I think we got a notice from the men saying, honey, go for it. Yeah, go for it. Be free today. Well, again, you're going to want to go outside after service and go ahead and get your hands on some of these amazing totes and tumblers, journals, other things we have out there. And then online, following our conference, we're going to have available all the audio, all the video recordings. You're going to want to get that conference set at wordoflifehawaii.com, because we need to hear the word over and over and over and over again. I mean, I couldn't take notes fast enough this weekend. So men, yes, it was a women's conference, but that's just because women were ministering. But what we were ministering is the word, which is to everybody. So mighty men, you get a hold of those conference recordings as well, audio and video, and you will be blessed by them. Also online, how many of you are blessed by Pastor Kuna's ministry? Whenever she worships, oh, the anointing, the healing anointing on her life as she ministers through song, as she ministers through the word, all of that is also available at wordoflifehawaii.com. And you can get a hold of her recordings. Send them to people who are in the hospital. Send them to your family and friends who need the touch and the presence of God and the power of God. Want to encourage you to do that. And you can also pick up some devoted sweatshirts, black and white devoted sweatshirts online as well. So we have so much available for you. Go ahead and check out the website. And speaking of checking things out, we have a video we'd like to show you. So if you could please turn your attentions to the screen.
You stepped into the overflow of the Holy Spirit. We've been in this, our devoted conference, it really began last Sunday. So we know that we're just stepping in for all that God has for us. The more, the more, the more. And right now, it's my honor and privilege to minister to us on tithes and offering. This is the time we get excited in the house of God. My name's Nicole Silva. I'm one of the pastors here at Word of Life. And one of the principles that God has shown me from the time I was a little kid in this church to this moment is how important it is for us whenever this opportunity comes in our presence to really understand that the tithe is the measure of your obedience and the generosity is the measure of your your offering. I was thinking generosity. Your offering, see, it is our foundation. Our offering is the measure of your generosity. So tithes and offering, it's out of our hearts that we give. It's out of our hearts that we say, Lord, everything I have is yours. And as I was praying in any time, I always think of this story in the Bible found in Mark 12, 41 to 44. I'm going to be reading from the Message Bible. You can write this in your notebooks and look back at it. But this is a story where Jesus was sitting there in this time and he was able to share with his disciples what he saw. This story in the Message goes like this. Sitting across from the offering box, he was observing how the crowd tossed money in the collection. Many of the rich were making large contributions. One poor widow came up and put in two small coins, a measly 2 cents. Jesus called his disciples over and said, "The truth is that this poor widow gave more to the collection than all the others put together. All the others gave what they'll never miss. She gave extravagantly what she couldn't afford. She gave her all." Now, this is where we see in the story, it's not so much about the amount because, you know, the people who are giving, they were just giving out of giving and giving, you know. But what I see in this woman is a principle of faith that we can all live by. And this principle is understanding that God is our source. God has all that we need. And anytime we have this opportunity, it's this heart of obedience, yet it's the heart of generosity. It's saying, Lord, I trust you with everything. We're in a weekend called Women of Faith-Filled Influence. And today we're pressing in as men and women of faith-filled influence. And you might be asking and wondering, how is God my source? Well, we see in Philippians 4:19, it says, "My God shall supply all your needs according to his riches in glory by Christ Jesus." Or, "My God shall supply all my needs in his glory." All your needs according to his riches in glory by Christ Jesus. In him we have all that we need. It doesn't matter what it looks like in our economy, what it looks like in the natural, what it looks like. Maybe sometimes today you're like, well, I was actually saving this for this moment, or I was saving it for 7-Eleven, or I was saving it for Starbucks, or I was saving it for my lunch, or this or that. Yet when it comes to any opportunity we have to give to God, I always think of this woman who gave everything she had because she trusted God with her life. She trusted God, saying, "Lord, I'm going to give you the only 2 cents I have, the only things I carried, because I know you are my provider." I don't know. It doesn't say what this woman was going through. It didn't say her circumstance or the challenges she was facing. Yet she chose to give. And in her heart of giving, I believe Jesus saw exactly the heart condition she had, which is trusting God. And I'm sure in that moment, her life was significantly changed. Because although we don't know her story or hear about this woman or know her name, Jesus mentioned her and it is written in the Bible. So there has to be something significant that God wants us to receive. Even when it comes to our tithes and our offering, it's, "Lord, we trust you with all that we have. You are our provider." We are stepping in as faith-filled, not fear-filled, not circumstance-filled, not situation-driven, but faith filled. And let's take that step of faith today to say, Lord, I give you. I give you out of my heart, Lord, in my tithes, in my offerings. I pour out my love to you. And I know that God sees every heart, everything you're going through, and he will meet the needs. He will be your provider. He'll make a way where there seems to be none. So right now, if you want to give an offering in person, classic style with an envelope, just lift your hands and our ushers and usherettes will be sure to hand out these envelopes. Or if you are giving online, you can just face your phone. And for those of you online, just click give, or you can face your phone and your camera to the QR code up there and just connect with us, and it'll take you straight to where you can give online. If this is your church, this is your house, I want to encourage you to sow your seeds. But if you belong to another church, be faithful to that church. But this, in this opportunity, this is where we say, Lord, we trust you. We put our faith in you. We give you our hearts. So as we're giving today, I always say, name your seed. What is this seed going for, Lord? What are we trusting that you will provide in? Maybe it's everything, and it should be all things that we trust you in. But maybe there's something specific, and that's that heart that God sees in the specific things. He's there. In the small details, he's there. So let's lift up our tithes and offering. If you can, if you're still writing in your envelope, don't worry, just finish it up. But for those of us who gave online, you can lift up your phones, your devices, or there at home, just lift up your phone and your device. Bow your heads and close your eyes, and let's just give this to God. Father, we thank you for this opportunity to be in your presence. We thank you, Lord God, for leading us, Lord, to be those who are not just obedient, but generous, Lord God. Those whose hearts are in our giving, Lord God. Those who know that with you, we have all that we need. You are our provider. Lord, I pray that you see the heart in everyone's giving, every family, every person, every woman, man, child, Lord God, that is represented here today. Lord, that you continuously show yourself strong. So have your way. Receive our tithe and offering as a sweet smelling aroma unto you. We love you, Lord. We honor you. We worship you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen and amen.
Women of faith filled influence. That's really how God sees us. He sees us as his women who are full of faith in him. Women who are placing our faith, our confidence, our trust on a good and faithful God. Faith is in our heart and it's in our mouth. So we believe what God says and we declare what God says, that no matter what we're facing, we can declare to those circumstances and we say, be removed, be cast into the sea. We speak that faith over our bodies for health, over our finances, over our relationships. We speak his word, and he gets involved when we are in faith. That's the only way to please him. I believe that we are like the woman of Matthew 15, who pressed in against the impossible circumstances and kept saying, but Jesus, you're able, but Jesus, you're willing. And if you'll get involved with my situation, I know the breakthrough will be manifested. Jesus' response to that Canaanite woman that wouldn't give up, believing for the breakthrough for her daughter, he said to her, oh woman, your faith is something else. What you want is what you get. And I believe that that's what God's saying to us right now. So he's saying, women, my girls, rise up.
Let faith rise up, oh heart. Let faith rise up in me.
Stay awake. Stand firm in your faith. Be brave. Be strong. Fight the good fight of faith. Persevere. Don't give up, God says, because I'm able and willing to do for you exceedingly abundantly above all you could dare ask or think, according to my power that's at work in you. And what is that power, ladies? It's that power of faith. It's that power of expectation in our God.
Let's pray, rise up,
rise up and be who He's called us to be, filled with faith in our faithful God. Let faith rise up. Keep your press. Don't give up. Keep saying what you know to say of my truth. Keep exercising your authority and enforce the devil's defeat. That's who we are. We are women of faith-filled influence. And God will show up and show out on our behalf. Let's keep trusting Him. Let's take the limits off of Him. He makes the impossible possible when we stay in faith. And He'll say to us, woman, your faith is something else. What you want is what you get. That's what I declare for us, because we're full of faith and we're full of expectation. He will be faithful. Women of faith-filled influence, faith-filled are we, and faithful is our God.
We are royalty. God created us fearfully and wonderfully. We are breathed from dust. His kingdom is our destiny. We are born to be more than
to believe.
it's anchored in praise. And when it's the darkest, it reaches the farthest and opens the way. Oh, don't need to see it.
Eyes on you.
Or to believe it.
I am Pastor Lily Montano from Word of Life Santa Barbara, and I wanted to thank Pastor Kuna for this opportunity. This past year and a half to 2 years has been something else. Many has faced tragedies, adversities like never before. It has been very difficult. Nevertheless, the Bible says in Romans 8:37 that in all these things, we are more than conquerors through Him, Jesus. Last year was a particularly challenging year for us. I lost my brother to COVID, and our daughter lost a baby, and the list goes on and on. But in all those things, we are more than conquerors. Why? Because greater is He that lives in me than he that lives in the world. You can make a list of all the challenges you live in the past 2 years, but make sure you end it with this. In all these things, we are more than conquerors through Him, Jesus. Can you say it loud with me? In all these things, we are more than conquerors through Christ Jesus. Yes, the Apostle Paul says also, be cheerful with joyous celebration in every season of life. So no matter what you encounter, be joyful and trust that in all these things, we are more than conquerors through Christ Jesus. Amen. God bless you.
Amen. Pastor Liliana from Word of Life Santa Barbara is in the house with Steffi. Come say hi to the people. We're so excited that we have you with us. It's been an exciting weekend. It's been a miracle weekend. I said it's a miracle weekend. Amen. We have the privilege of getting to hear from my pastor, Pastor Cesar and Pastor Emma Claudia Castellanos, our pastors. Pastor Art and I are blessed to have them as our pastors. And they have helped us in so many areas of our lives. But we wanted to give an opportunity to get to hear from Pastor Emma Claudia. Now, we had a message. We heard a message from her earlier this week on Saturday. Actually, well, no, it was Friday night. Right? Friday night. It's all coming together here. And so I wanted to be able to share another. She's got another message. This is a different message. Wow. Yeah, this is not a repeat, family. This is another message. I asked her to share two messages with us, and I'm so blessed that she took the time. She's a very busy woman. She's a senator for the Republic of Colombia. She's also served as a counselor and an ambassador in the Republic of Brazil. She's a busy woman. And she, along with her husband, Pastor Cesar, oversee Mission Charismatic International there in Bogota, Colombia. And they have MCI churches across the globe, as well as there in the nation of Colombia. We're so grateful that they embraced this heavenly vision to win souls and make disciples. And they've helped us, Pastor Art and I, and countless leaders across the globe to embrace that heartbeat of God as well. And so together we lock arms, and we're a part of this G12 vision, this heavenly vision that's bringing family in, that's bringing salvation to cities, nations, and really to the world. So I'm going to ask you to stand to your feet. Let's give honor to whom honor is due. That's what we do here at Word of Life Christian Center. We're doers of the word and not hearers only. The Bible says to give honor to whom honor is due. This is our pastor. This is a woman of God who has spoken into my life and helped me to be the mother, the Mimi, the leader, the pastor that God's called me to be. There's such a grace that she carries, and I'm blessed and honored to be under her leadership. We are open to receive from Pastor Emma Claudia this morning. In Jesus' name, put your hands together for her. Amen. And you may be seated, family. Thank you.
To be in this conference again, women of influence, women of faith, women that will have an impartation of love. And for me, it's a privilege to be able to address you from the city of Bogota, Colombia. And I know that the Holy Spirit will impart, will minister, and will guide us through the word with what he wants and what we need to not just be better disciples, but for us to take on those roles that we have as women, as wives, as mothers, as women that perhaps have a responsibility in government, in business, or in any function that you have within society. I can share with you that for more than 36 years, I had the opportunity of having a pastor. I always imagined that our pastor would live in the same city and even close to our home, but it wasn't like that. For years, we felt disoriented, and just like everyone needs a natural father, they also need a spiritual father. And we had the opportunity of reading one of the books of Pastor Cho, The Fourth Dimension, and something happened in our hearts. We felt it was a word of direction. For the first time, we understood the language of visions and dreams. And that which you need came, and what I needed in that time, which was faith. Faith to believe in the multitudes. Faith as well to feel that one has a message for the women, or that you have a calling to the redemption of a nation. Pastor Cho, today I want to honor the life of our pastor. He was born in 1936, and he died in September this year, when he was 85 years old. He was a man faithful to his calling, and today I am so grateful that all those revelations, that word, that compassion, he was able to transmit through these books that were written and translated into many languages. And of course, even though he didn't speak Spanish, effectively we received his teachings. We connected with him. We were able to travel to the nation and city of Seoul, Korea, South Korea, and something happened that I will remember forever, and they marked me. And that was when we had a great event in a coliseum where there were 100,000 women in that meeting. It was magnific. It was excellent. The stadium, the organization as such. And when I'm going in with all the delegations, I come close to Cesar and I said, "My love, this meeting was made just for me." And he said, "Why?" And I said, "Yes, because none of these pastors work with women. And what the Holy Spirit wants to show me through my pastor, that even though he didn't speak Spanish, he spoke Korean and English. And he's transmitting with his example, but with that impartation, with that ministry time, we had that afternoon with more than 100,000 women, I would walk through the galleries, I would raise my arm, I would greet them. And from one moment to another, I stopped being Asian women because they all had their almond eyes. And I started to see women with big eyes, like Colombian women. And I said, these are the disciples of the pastor. And I would name a pastor that was part of my team. That day, Pastor Cho, through this event, I can see that a mantle came, a revelation. There was a certainty that effectively I could pastor women. If you had met me years ago, I did not feel capable. I said, what will I say? I am not a woman for audiences. I married a man who had that calling. And perhaps for years, I thought that my function was just to accompany my husband. But to fulfill that calling, I had to understand the teaching that the Lord gave the disciples. And that's what I want to share with you. It's in Matthew 22, verse 36, from verse 36 onwards. Someone asked Jesus a question, and he says, Teacher, which is the greatest commandment in the law? And Jesus replied, love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your mind. This is the first and greatest commandment. All the law and the prophets hang on these two commandments. And the second is as great as this, love your neighbor as yourself. What can I understand there? Yes, you have a calling. And I know that all the women who are in this conference, they have probably cried out, they have asked for, they've interceded to have disciples, to transmit the vision and be able to multiply. I know it's a part of what we've taught. But what the Lord says is first you have to have an understanding of these two great commandments. Love God. Love God how? It says, with all your heart. Many of the years that we had conferences here in Colombia that were addressed to women, the name of the conference was One Heart. And when you think about the heart, what comes to your mind? A heart, what does it represent? A heart is like a container that is empty. Or it's full of what? Or it has perhaps an opening. If you have a jug or a cup, a glass, and it has a small hole, whatever the liquid that we have in this container, if there is a hole in it, it will be damaged because immediately it won't be contained. This container won't retain it, and this cup. And I could understand that, but the first thing we have to do with women is to heal the heart. Because the heart, it says you have to love the Lord with all your heart. But in your heart, there cannot be bitterness, resentment, sadness, doubts. There can be perhaps, questions, perhaps bitterness. Well, so many things that you keep in your heart. And he says, if you want to love me, the first thing you have to do and ask for is that your heart will be healed. And that's what we do in the encounters. That's why the vision is so powerful. An encounter with the Lord changes everything. Yesterday, that I had the chance of being with a pastor, he is at the head of the church of a department of Colombia called Nariño in the city of Pasto. It's in the south of Colombia, and it's to the border of the country of Ecuador, and he shared with me how his heart was full of hate for different circumstances. Since he was a child, he had a lot of family tragedies. His younger brother dies, two of his brothers are murdered, but he had hatred towards his mother, and his mother had a health problem. She has a heart attack, and seemingly she was about to die. And he had an encounter with the Lord. He had gone to an encounter, and he knew that his mother had not forgiven him yet. And he said, "Pastor, I did a very long trip, about 12 hours, and she was about to die between life and death, and I went the whole night in prayer just asking the Lord, don't let my mom pass away because I haven't felt her forgiveness, and what there was between us was hatred. But because he had that encounter with Jesus, he said that hatred was changed into acceptance, love, and forgiveness. But she had a few hours left to pass away. But he said, I could not have that freedom of serving you. I'm going to have this heavy conscience. Perhaps he had not been a good son. And God, you know, God heard him. And he said that his mother reacted. She didn't die in a miraculous way. Today, my mom is 85 years old. She's part of my team. She's a vigorous woman. And this happened 25 years ago. And this is a part of what the Lord wants to share with us. Your heart needs to be healed to release forgiveness. Your heart needs to be free. You have to have spontaneity and innocence. And we as women, we really need the Lord to give us that mantle of love, because there's nothing like a woman who expresses kindness, acceptance. We who are part of a family, or most of us who are mothers or grandmothers or wives, disciples, we have to express with words, with actions, but with the attitude, even when we have so many duties to pick up the mess of our children, or we feel that we have a great responsibility in our home, but let's never allow complaining or backbiting. That's why when the Lord says, you will love the Lord with all your heart. But your heart cannot be broken, because the Holy Spirit is the one that has to bring that love, genuine love, that innocent love, for you to express, as the psalmist says, praise the Lord, my soul and all my inmost being praise his holy name. A life without love is very sad. I looked at several biographies of men who were tyrants and dictators, and the common denominator was a life full of hatred. That's why they wanted to exterminate the Jews, or they had an imaginary enemy. They are cruel men, men who judge, who have the power of the murderer to take down others. But God, the Lord says, I want loving daughters. And a loving woman is like honey. You know, your husband, your children, your grandchildren, your disciples will be around you. Today, I want to honor the life of Kuna. The truth is, I never imagined to have disciples living in other countries. I thought the same thing that happened with my pastor, that he was from another nation, from South Korea. I never imagined that the Holy Spirit would give me the privilege of having a woman close to me, a woman of excellence, virtuous. Kuna, I admire you. I love you because you have been a fighter, a woman who, in the midst of difficulties, because yeah, it hasn't been easy, I've known you in many stages of your life, but I've seen the wisdom, the favor of God that's been on your life and given you so many victories. Kuna, I know that the Lord has raised you up in this time to be that prophetic voice, to be that voice that would give guidance, encouragement. For me, it's a privilege to have you as a part of my closest team and close to my heart. And I can just say that what God has given us, that inheritance is also for you. What is the part of that inheritance? To have a priestly family. The promises that he's given us today, this morning, that I was with one of my granddaughters while they were blow drying my hair and doing my makeup just to be here on the camera. I was sharing Isaiah 59 verse 21. And it's such a beautiful verse. I read it and I'm moved. Because it says, it talks about the covenant that God will do with his children. It says, Isaiah 59, I hadn't included it in this talk, but I know that the Lord wants me to share it with you. It says, as for me, this is my covenant with them, says the Lord. My spirit, who is on you, will not depart from you, and my words that I have put in your mouth will always be on your lips, on the lips of your children and on the lips of their descendants from this time on and forever, says the Lord. And I was explaining to my granddaughter, do you understand? She says, Grandmother, I can't read Spanish very well because she is American. She physically looks Latin, but her education has been North American. And I said, no, you will read Spanish very well. And she says, and you'll learn to read English. So there we challenge each other. So here it says, there is a covenant. And I give you a promise. That Holy Spirit that has come upon you, it's the Holy Spirit, it's the Spirit of love, the Spirit of acceptance, of consolation, not just every time you open your mouth, you will open your mouth. And I was saying to my granddaughter, say, ah, and she would say, ah. Right in that moment when you say, ah, the Spirit of God is flowing through you. Because here it's saying, and it's talking about your grandfather, of your grandmother, of course, but it's also speaking of the children who would be your mom. And that's why when your mother speaks, she speaks under the anointing of the Holy Spirit. But not just that, but it speaks of the grandchildren. And the truth is, dear friends, this verse touched my heart because I have the privilege of having 14 grandchildren and conferences this week. My daughter Manuela will give birth to Grace. And I think this is what's coming for us, the grace of loving. Look, this world needs love. And it's a love that is expressed with dedication, with the discipline when I read the word, but also in my relationship with my neighbors. That's why the Lord says, yes, you're going to love the Lord with all your heart, with all your soul, and the soul is stubborn. The soul is like, it's like a will. Sometimes we want to have our way and guide the Lord in our prayers. And that's why Pastor Cesar always speaks to us about what you think, what you want, or what you love is not so important. That's why your soul has to be before the cross. And when it's before the cross is when you can say, no, Lord, I wanted to go to the right, but have your way. No, yes, have your way. And that's why it says, love the Lord your God with all your soul. And when it says all your soul and with all your mind, how interesting it is to see in the Bible, in many passages of the Bible, it says, the perverse man, the unrighteous, the bloodthirsty man is the one whose thoughts, in his thoughts, he says, there is no God. I can share with you, dear friends, that we are very close to electing the next president in Colombia. And there was a survey. So, as or every government does before every election. And the result of that survey was a poll. The Colombians said, we will never vote for a man who will be an atheist. And there are some candidates that call themselves atheists. So immediately they changed their discourse. And I said, what's going on? Something is going on in the Colombian culture. The thought of many is being changed. And they're saying, no, we want a governor where God lives and who has God. That's why I believe the United States and the islands of Hawaii and Asia and all the countries where we can share and preach this gospel have to say, this is the first and greatest commandment, to live, we would say, under the banner of love. This world needs love. Love from the biblical perspective, because you know that love has a direction, but there are also moments of correction. Sometimes there are times of struggles, but we know that our loving Father guides us, so we will not leave the path. That's why, dear women, love God with all your heart, but that heart must be healed. With all your soul, but that soul has to be before the cross every day, and love Him as well with your thoughts, because those thoughts have to be surrendered, have to be trained by the Word of God. That's why this great promise of Isaiah 59:21, I was instructing my granddaughter, because she had a thought, perhaps of fear, when she spoke in public. And I realized that. That's why I said, oh, I have to teach her. Daughter, don't be afraid. Be sure that when you open your mouth, it's the Holy Spirit that is ministering and is bringing that consolation. This message that the Lord gave is for you to know that if you ask for it, He will give you an immersion of love, of an extravagant love, a love where you will see everything so different. I assure you that when you leave the conference today, you see the trees are greener, the sea is bluer, the sun shines brighter, you'll hear the birds singing, you'll see everything so beautiful, and perhaps before you frowned, everything smelled bad, you would criticize, you would murmur, you would complain, and you didn't see the blessings that were around you. Dear woman, He wants to do something with you. He wants to mark you. He wants to give you a seal. And that seal is the seal of love. There's nothing like a loving woman. A loving woman is radiant, is happy, and she's accepted by the Holy Spirit. A woman who loves is a woman who knows how to be in intercession. She knows she has a mission of giving a message of redemption. That's why I know that in this conference, that's what will come. The mantle of consolation will come, but of knowing that if we have the love of God, it will be reflected in love to our neighbor. Some years ago, we had a conference in Lima, Peru. And, well, before every conference, it was in a very nice hotel. We always arrived in that place, and I met the young girl that would be my stylist and blow-dry my hair. She was a very happy girl. She was very sweet. And every year, at the same date, I would arrive at that place. And on that occasion, it was like maybe the sixth year of going to Lima. And when I arrived there, I saw that she was gaunt, she was different, as if she had lost a dear family member. She had a different face, and I said, I'd never shared the gospel with her. And she opened her heart and she says, no, I'm about to get divorced. My husband left me. He doesn't love me anymore. And my world fell to pieces. And I start to minister to her, and it was so beautiful. Like the grace of God was there to lead her, to tell her, even if your husband is failing, I will introduce you to someone who would never fail you, and it's Jesus. Jesus is knocking at the door of your heart. And if you open the door of your soul and your heart, he will fill all emptiness. And she did that in an act of faith. And effectively, there was a genuine transformation. Later, she said that she came as a tourist to Colombia. She fell in love with Colombia. But, well, I don't want to go into details, but God did a miracle in her family, in her marriage. And she came to Colombia to live here. And then she told me that day, I had been for 3 days in an encounter, but not an encounter guided by the Holy Spirit. It was an encounter where darkness came to my home. And I just heard a voice that said, no one loves you. No one loves you. There's no worth living. And she says that in one moment she had a glass. The glass falls, it breaks, and the voice told her, cut your veins. You don't deserve to live. And in that moment, she started to shake. Sorry, the phone started to ring. It rang and rang and rang. And the curtains were, it was dark. She was about to take her own life. And in that moment, the phone rings. She has a daughter, and she says, Mom, they're asking for you to go and to do someone's hair to the hotel. And that was my call that day to be doing the service for me. And that was the moment when I had the chance to share with her. A woman who felt rejected and didn't feel loved by her husband, but in that moment of tribulation, God allowed those circumstances for me to show to her the biggest love, the extravagant love of our Lord Jesus Christ, who picked her up. And I can say today, she's a pastor. She's a pastor, a leader, and I love her deeply. Our dear sister, I won't give her name, but it's a testimony that moves us, and it's a testimony full of love. God restored her marriage, and today she's getting ready in Colombia to then go back to Peru, God willing, and continue transmitting this love. That's why the Bible, when it says, if you love me, you have to love your neighbor. And loving our neighbor is to see the need. What need is there? And I know that if today you ask for that kind of love, I assure you it will come. It will come and it will surprise you. And it doesn't matter your age, your past, or if you felt like a failure or frustrated, or perhaps you say, no, I failed God. He forgives and he restores. He loves, he delivers, he blesses us. A blessing that you're surprised. He's going to surprise you. But I assure you that from now onwards, you will be the most loving woman. That when you get home after this conference, your husband will say, what happened? You look different. You look beautiful. You look beautiful, stunning. Your husband will be chasing you. What happened? You attract me. And then when you're at the table with your children, they'll say, Mom, I love to be with you. You smell beautiful. That soup, that's always the same soup. It tastes delicious. Mom, I love to speak to you. I like to talk to you if they're adult children. I love to chat with you. There's nothing like living under the banner of love. And today, I just want to pray for you. If anyone has a tribulation, if any of these women have felt rejected or that they haven't had love around them, I want to tell you the Holy Spirit will visit you and will embrace you and love you and comfort you and give you that dignity that perhaps you haven't felt for a long time. Let's pray. And we're going to ask that the Lord will fill us with that love, that extravagant love, that love that has no explanations, as 1 Corinthians chapter 13 says, that even though we would deliver up our body to be burned, to have sacrifices, but if we have not love, even though I would speak angelic tongues and prophesy, if I don't have love, I am nothing. That's why the first commandment is to love, and to love God implies that your container, your heart, God will fill it with that love that brings acceptance, where there is no condemnation. There's no condemnation in Christ Jesus, where you feel that you are a woman with purpose, and the Lord will guide you in everything. So put your hand on your heart and say, Lord, first forgive me. Forgive me because sometimes I thought that no one loved me. I thought I was a lost cause, that I have failed so many times that I didn't deserve to be forgiven. But today I repent, God, and today I recognize what your word says. For God so loved the world that he gave his only son, so that whoever believes in him should not perish, but have eternal life. And I believe in that love. That love makes me be included in the body of Christ, to be part again of God's great family. And I accept the fatherly love of my Heavenly Father. And I accept that for him to take me as a girl, to take me by the hand and tell me, daughter, from now on, everything will be different. But even more, I feel the love from him, that love that surpasses all understanding, and that love covers me, protects me, gives me a new dress, and gives me a security of my salvation, and the responsibility that I have or will have, and I will assume in the power of the Holy Spirit. And I believe it, Lord, in Christ Jesus. Dear friends, what a privilege to have been with you. I know that soon the Lord will give me the opportunity of going to Hawaii, of going to that precious island. It really is an amazing blessing. And I would perhaps take all of my grandchildren before the end of this year. I want to do again my book of dreams, and I'm going to put their trip to Hawaii. And I'll see you there. God bless you. A big hug and a big kiss.
Amen. Let's give Pastor Emma Claudia a hand. Let's give honor to whom honor is due. I just love hearing the heart of our pastor, Pastor Emma Claudia, the anointing that she carries, just the prophetic voice that she has. And she's been such a blessing to not only Pastor Kuna and Pastor Art, but to our entire family. And she always has a word in season for us. And today I receive that. I receive that word for me, receive that word for you, receive that word for your family. Let's live under the banner of love. And truly, I cherish the words she shared to Pastor Kuna a moment ago from Isaiah 59. I believe that's something that we all are called to live under as priestly families who belong to God. No matter what things look like in the natural, continue to trust God. This is the heart of the vision. This is the heart of the Father. This is the heart of what God longs to do for every family, for every marriage, no matter where you are. Nothing is impossible with God. And now it's a joy to move into the next speaker, which we see truly how the anointing flows from the head down. Pastor Emma Claudia is an example in every way, in every season, as a senator, as a woman of God, as a wife, mother, pastor, leader, disciple maker. And now we're going to hear from her eldest daughter, her oldest daughter, Pastor Johanna Proença. I don't say it very well. It's Portuguese. Proença? Yeah. Anyways, we love her, and she has an amazing heart. She truly is the fruit of her mother's heart and really has a voice for every generation. Alongside her husband, Pastor Ellie Emerson, they have three daughters and they are impacting the world with the gospel and the vision. They are a part of Pastor Cesar and Pastora Emma Claudia's primary team of 12 in Bogota, but they are also senior pastors at MCI in Miami, overseeing their campus there in Miami, as well as G12 coordinators in Brazil. So they have a ministry in Bogota, which is flourishing and growing. Then they have a ministry going on in the U.S., which is flourishing and growing, and they have a ministry happening, helping to coordinate the nation of Brazil. And I believe that shows us that when we are focused on God, He can help us to be effective. She has many books, one that we love and we use with our young people called I Love. All parents and families get a hold of that book, and many other books that just share the heart of God in her life that she's lived out. And I believe she has a word for us. She's family to us. She calls my mom her older sister because they're like two peas in a pod and they had a special connection in one of their trips. But to us, we also look to her as our older sister and one that always ministers and brings life to us. So let's continue to lean in today as we receive the overflow of the anointing that flows from the head down. Let's receive from Pastora Johanna.
Aloha. What a pleasure to greet you, Pastor Kuna. Thank you for this invitation to this women's conference. We are always super fans of Hawaii. We love Hawaii. My daughters always ask me, Mom, when are we going to go back to Hawaii? Because undoubtedly, it's an incredible place, but with people who are passionate. And in this conference, that's what we're going to be learning, how to give more of this passion that the Lord has given us to others. And a very special greeting as well to your daughters. I always see them on social media. I'm following them and I see how they are forming a family in the Lord, and I love to be a part of their family, of their story. And of course, Pastor, to you, we love you, Art. A very strong hand from Ellie Emerson as well. And we hope to see you soon, perhaps in the January conference. So a very warm hug to all of you. And now we're going to go right into the subject, all right? The subject we'll be learning today is let's be light. Undoubtedly, we need light for everything. Light allows us to see those things we can't see. I find myself in Bogota, Colombia, but I live in Miami, in Florida, and I've seen how in the midst of this pandemic, it hasn't been so easy, and what we're seeing. I want to give you some statistics of what's happened in the midst of this pandemic in the USA, and we can say that between March and April, nearly 113,000 women called and requested for emergency help for violence problems at home. 113,000 women have asked for help. And this gives an average of one woman every minute. Do we perhaps need to be a light in the midst of our city? We also find that the hotline of the USA received 50,000 calls. 50,000 calls from families that asked for help. In between 2020 and 2021, 44,834 people died because of suicide. Do we need to be a light? And we can continue with more information about this that shows us how important it is to be a light in the midst of our city. Now, that's why the theme that I wanted to share today is that we need to be light. This last week, we had our men's conference,
And Pastor Rafael Perez shared a very interesting story in one of the devotionals where he spoke when he lived in Chile. There was an earthquake, and in the midst of that earthquake, it was very early in the morning, like 3 o'clock in the morning, and he wakes up his wife, his children, telling them, "We have to leave this apartment." They managed to leave, they're outside, and he says that during that whole time, it was a question of seconds, and they managed to leave. But when they got outside, the lights went out, and many people, because they didn't have lights, they couldn't find the door to exit. And for that reason, many died because they couldn't see the way out. So he said, thank God, we and our family were able to see the light. Now, we're going to look a bit closer at what it is to be light. And I'm going to ask here the team, the media team, can you switch off the light for a moment? When the light goes out, when the light's not there, when the light's turned off, it's probably difficult. No, not probably. It is very difficult to see what's in front of us. Perhaps in this moment, you can't see me clearly. Perhaps you see my silhouette. But you can't probably see the expressions on my face and what I'm feeling. I think this pandemic has brought a lot of darkness, perhaps, to our surroundings and undoubtedly our cities, the communities where we live, or the nation where we are in, has been in darkness. But what does Jesus say? He says, I am the light of the world. He says it. Say it with me. Jesus says, I am the light of the world. And when we start to receive that light, something in us starts to shine. So here I have a bulb, a light bulb, and I just turned it on. And this light bulb, now you can probably see me a bit clearer. Perhaps you're starting to see that there's someone there. There's someone that has a light. And I want to tell you, where you are, the region where you live, needs to see that light that God is placing in you, that He's put in you. But as you take from that source of light, this light will become brighter and greater, and many more people will be able to see you. Amen? So why don't you repeat after me? Lord, I want to be the light that my city needs. Thank you to the media team. Now we're going to switch on our lights again, believing that this is a time to be light. Mark 12:30-31, what does it say? Love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your mind and with all your strength. This is the main commandment, the greatest. And I think that in this time of conferences, we use this to have this encounter with God. And probably in the midst of your conference, that's what you're experiencing. You're looking to have an encounter with God, to love Him with all your strength. And I want to motivate you that you would have this in mind, this passage of Mark 12:30. Where you're evaluating, Lord, how am I loving you? Am I loving you with all my heart? Am I loving you with all my soul? Am I loving you with all my mind, with that knowledge that you've given me? Am I loving you with all my strength?
How are you loving the Lord? Perhaps if you're at home, if you're in your sitting room, ask that family that is next to you, you can ask them, how are you loving the Lord? I'm going to ask here the media team, how are you loving the Lord? How are you loving Him? With all your mind, with all your heart. Media team, they're a bit shy. How are you loving Him? With all your mind, all your heart, all your strength. How are you loving Him? Well, verse 31 says, the second is this, love your neighbor as yourself. There is no commandment greater than these. Read it again with me. You'll see it on the screen. Love your neighbor as yourself. Our community needs to see the light that God has put in our lives. Psalm 119, 105 says, your word is a lamp for my feet, a light on my path. We need the Lord to shine and lighten our path and our feet. That's why we have to have contact with the Word on a daily basis. This last year, my second daughter had a goal to read the Bible in a year. And at 10 years old, she was able to do it. She read the Bible in 1 year and she says, Mom, it's been so beautiful to challenge myself to read the Bible in a year and be able to grow in my friendship with the Lord. And this is leading her to have clarity, a clarity of what God wants to do with her life. And she's a 10-year-old girl. Now, you and me, what are we doing to grow in the knowledge of the Word of God? Don't become comfortable with what you're doing. Perhaps you have been for a long time having that same time in your devotional. You've been doing the same for a long time. Now it's time to innovate. If we want that light of God to shine in a stronger way in our lives, I need to grow more and more in my communion with the Lord. Now, I want to ask you, what is the opposite to love? The opposite to love is hate. And perhaps we're in an era where it's easier to hate than to love. It's easier to say, no, I don't want to support. I don't want to do that. I don't want to commit myself. The other day, we were leaving a baby shower. We were in a park sharing with the family that's going to have this baby. And when we left, we got into our car and we got to the traffic light. At the traffic light in front of us, there were some cars that had crashed softly. When they crashed, well, generally you open the door of the car, you look and you see what's happening. But the young guy who crashed into the other, I think he did not expect the reaction that this man would have. He leaves his car and he took him and started to beat him. He puts him on the floor and he didn't stop hitting him. The cars would drive by and they were all observing, and it was a thing of seconds, and they give him amazing beating, and then he got into the car and he left. Sometimes there are people who it's easier for them to hate than to love. But God says, if you love, you have to demonstrate that love to your neighbor. That love that the Lord has put in your life, you have to demonstrate it, and demonstrate it with your actions, with your words to your neighbor. So today, make that prayer. Lord, show me, teach me how to love. Love with my actions. Teach me how to love with my words, that you can guide me and lead me in what love is. Here the word says in the book of John, chapter 13, chapter 15, it's a very interesting passage where this is a parable the Lord Jesus gives. And in this parable, in my Spanish Bible,
It mentions 11 times the word remain, John 15. So Jesus gives this parable on the vine, and he says, if you are that branch, you have to embrace you. And this is very interesting, but let's read verse 10, John 15, 10. What does it say? If you keep my commands, you will remain in my love, just as I have kept my Father's commands and remain in his love. I have told you this so that my joy may be in you and that your joy may be complete. My command is this: love each other as I have loved you. Greater love has no one than this, to lay down one's life for one's friends. Wow. What an amazing passage. Verse 13, read it again. Greater love has no one than this, to lay down one's life for one's friends. Do I love in that way? Am I willing to love in the same way that Jesus loved? Am I willing to have a sincere love that gives everything, a love that is not selfish, but loves completely? How is your love? Not long ago, I read the story of a man who was called Mike Mansour. Here, you're going to see his photo. Mike Mansour, what do you know about him? Who was he? Perhaps you don't know his story, but today I want to tell you. On September 29th, 2006, a group of U.S. Navy SEALs found themselves on the roof of a house in Ramadi, Iraq. They were protecting and vigilating the city when an insurgent threw a grenade to where these four men were. Mike's friends say that he was the one who was closest to the exit door, but Mike, in a question of seconds, made a decision. Instead of running away, Mike threw himself on the grenade and he became a shield of protection for his three friends. Mike was taken to the doctors and medical team, and half an hour after this grenade exploded, he died, giving his life for his friends. His friends are sure that Mike could have escaped from this accident, but he made the decision of loving his friends and give his life for his friends. Now, if you and I were in that same situation, would we have done the same thing that Mike Mansour did? Would we have given our lives for our friends? Or would we have run away? Today, these three friends enjoy a life thanks to the sacrifice this friend did on that day, that night of September 29th in Ramadi, Iraq. Our love has to grow. We can't be selfish. Yesterday, I found myself in the conference in a worship time that was beautiful. Generation 12 were ministering. We were singing about healing our land. And it was a very beautiful time in the midst of the conference, even though it was a men's conference. We were there wanting to receive. And I was with a friend of mine who's Pastor Elina from Brazil. And in that moment, it was like some guiding words of a prayer came. And they were saying, what do you want? Ask the Lord what you're yearning for, what you desire. And I asked Pastor Aline, what is your petition? What is your request? What would you like? And he looked at me. She was very broken. And she said, I just want to be more like Jesus. I want to love like Jesus loved, have the maturity that my Lord wants me to have. I want to be a woman that would follow Jesus' footsteps and reflect Jesus wherever I am.
And both of us hugged and prayed, and we broke down together. Because sometimes it's easy to read these verses, but to put them in practice is another story. So today, church, how is your love? Are we willing to love? Today we've had, or have we had, a selfish love? Our love first starts at home, with our spouse, with our children. Our love has to grow. That which we are shining forth has to grow, that it would reach our community, that our neighbors, the friends around us can see that you're not that bitter person, the bitter person of the whole city, but you are a good neighbor. You are a person who transmits light, a person who is an example in everything they do. So let's determine to love as Jesus loved. If we remain in Him, we will achieve to love. I know that perhaps many have had stories or past lives where they perhaps didn't teach you to love. It wasn't easy. But when you remain in the Lord, you start to love in a different way. You start to love like Jesus loved us, with all His heart, with all their soul, with all our minds, and with all our strength. That is the love that God desires us to be giving to our city, to our community, to the place where we are. 1 John, chapter 3, verse 11 and 12. For this is the message you heard from the beginning. We should love one another. Do not be like Cain, who belonged to the evil one and murdered his brother. And why did he murder him? Because his own actions were evil and his brother's were righteous. Here we find clearly the message the Lord gives us, that we would love one another, and that we will not follow Cain's example, what we were saying. The opposite of love is hate, and hate can lead us to hurt others with our words, to hurt others with our actions, to hurt others even with a single look. Today you're going to ask the Lord that you want to be light and you want to shine that love wherever you are. Matthew 5:23. What does it say? Therefore, if you are offering your gift at the altar and there, remember that your brother or sister has something against you, leave your gift there in front of the altar. First, go and be reconciled to them. Then come and offer your gift. Wow, what a message the Lord is giving us. We want the blessing of prosperity. Lord, look at this offering and bless us. But here the Lord has given us a requisite, a reason for us is to love our neighbor first, to reconcile ourselves with our neighbor. I think we have to stop being Christians that are teenagers, children, to be mature Christians. I know this is a church where the Lord is leading you to a greater level in your maturity. The Lord is leading you to a greater level in your maturity. I have teenage girls, teenage daughters, and I share with a lot of teenagers. And sometimes teenagers have immature actions where perhaps someone arrives, they looked at me wrongly, so now I don't say hello, I don't get along with you, you're not from my circle, and they say to everyone else, don't talk with him. Church, you're immature, no more. You can't get to church and say, I'm not going to say hello to this person because I don't get on with them. No, what is the Lord saying? To be a child of God is to love my neighbor. So I hope, pastors of this church, I hope you don't have to give any more advice saying, oh, this disciple again, they're in conflict with this other family. No. No more. It's time to mature. It's time to grow. It's time to be those children
who give light wherever we are and wherever we go. Romans 12, verse 9 says, love must be sincere, not hypocrite. Hate what is evil. Cling to what is good. Verse 10 says, be devoted to one another in love, in fraternal love, and honor one another above yourselves. Love is manifested and reflected by honoring my neighbor. How are you going to know honor your neighbor? Some time ago, my eldest daughter decided to be a good neighbor. So she bought the ingredients to bake a loaf of bread. I had no idea how to bake bread, but my daughter bought the ingredients and elements, and she baked a loaf of bread, and she said, Mom, Dad, this is not for you. This is for our neighbor. And she went out with her dad. She took this homemade bread to our neighbor and gave it to him with love. We honored them with that, but now our neighbors love us so much for this action that my 12-year-old daughter had with that neighbor. They have a farm or vegetable garden where they cultivate food. And there are times when they bring lettuce, they bring corn, they bring several products they have in their farm to our home. And this was because of that honor that my daughter had demonstrated with them on one single day. And that was for November in Thanksgiving. So I want to motivate you that you would honor with your words, honor with your friendship, honor with a nice detail. Follow the example of Jesus, verse 7, never be lacking in zeal, but keep your spiritual fervor, serving the Lord. Do you know something? Love is also seen reflected in your service. Participate in your church and serve. If you see a friend who perhaps is needing something, serve them. You know, without any second motivation, let's look to serve each other, loving each other. Verse 12, this must be one of your favorite. Be joyful in hope, patient in affliction, faithful in prayer. Joy is a reflection of love and prayer as well. We have to be people or churches who grow in intercession, who grow in prayer. I think one of the things that this pandemic has taught us the most is prayer. Pastor Emma Claudia started an intercession initially for 40 days. And we have not stopped. We are now in our seventh cycle of intercession of 40 days. And women around the world have joined to this time of intercession. Last week, I preached in the city of Miami. And when I was there, a woman came, a Puerto Rican woman. She arrived joyful. She was full of joy. She said, Pastor, I have to tell you a testimony. I joined the intercession for 40 days. I prayed for my mom. She's more than 19 years old, for her cancer, and God healed her completely. We started to see many miracles because of intercession. Church, get up to intercede. Love is also reflected in prayer. Verse 13, share with the Lord's people who are in need. Practice hospitality. Love is reflected in my generosity with others, but also in the way that I am hospitable, to serve, to be kind, to bless others with what God has given me. Verse 14, this one is not so easy because it says, bless those who persecute you. Bless and do not curse. Is it easy to bless those who are our enemies? Perhaps it's not so easy. But the Lord says, if you follow me, if you are my disciple, if you're an example, you will bless and not curse, even those who harm you.
verse 16, live in harmony with one another. Do not be proud, but be willing to associate with people of low position. Do not be conceited. A time of unity, a time of harmony, and also be careful of your friendships, careful with those you surround yourself with, that they would be a reflection of what you are being. And we finish verse 17 and 18. Do not repay anyone evil for evil. Be careful to do what is right in the eyes of everyone. If it is possible, as far as it depends on you, live at peace with everyone. How amazing. We can't return bad for bad, for doing something evil. We have to try and be righteous and live, if possible, if you can do it, if it depends on you, then try to live at peace with everyone who's around you. What is the Lord teaching us with all of this, and what is the purpose of this ministry? Time. The purpose is that to be light has to be reflected in that commandment to love your neighbor as yourself. How can you be light? How can you love your neighbor? By serving, by doing everything we've just read, everything we've just studied. And today I want to invite you to pray this prayer with me. Perhaps we haven't known how to love. We've been selfish. Perhaps we have been feeling in this dark world, and we've raised up barriers of darkness. I know that in this pandemic, a lot of people have gone through valleys of frustration, of failure, where people have felt, well, like afflicted by everything that's happened around us. But today the Lord tells you, I am the light. And that light will be in the midst of you. That light comes into your life, and you will start being a light to those who are around you. So church, let's pray together and ask the Lord for this. Close your eyes with me and say to the Lord, Lord, thank you. Thank you for this conference. Thank you, Lord, for this time of ministry. Thank you, Lord, because today you teach me how necessary it is to love. I ask you to teach me how to love. Teach me what love is. I don't want to be selfish. I don't want to be immature. I don't want to keep behaving in an incorrect way. Teach me how to love. Ask the Lord, teach me how to love my neighbor. I want to be light in my city. I want to transmit this love, starting in my own home, but also to those who are around me. I want to be a light in the midst of my community. Lord, today I thank you for every family, every person who's joined us in this conference. Today, Holy Spirit, we pray that there would be open heavens over their homes, that the light of Jesus would come with a greater strength to this home, and that all this home and family can be a reflection of your glory, a reflection of your love, a reflection of your power, Lord. Activate them to love their neighbor, to love them, giving their best and serving in their church and serving in their community, Lord. Activate them to be people who are diligent, as your word says, not lazy, but being active in everything. Today I bless them and I thank you for their lives. In Jesus' name, amen and amen.
Amen. Thank you, family. If you would stand, please. I was just really endeavoring to get as much into us as possible. We had an amazing conference yesterday. And thank you. Thank you for going the extra mile. It's so good to see all of you. The balcony got fuller, yeah, it's so wonderful to see all of you. Thank you. So you can go outside and enjoy the boutique and different time, you know, what's out there. The cafe's open, and at the next service, we'll have another set of speakers. It's a little bit shorter than this service. I just wanted to honor Pastora Emma Claudia at the service that we have the most of us online as well as in person. So thank you for understanding my heart. And I wanted to do as much as I could with packing in as many speakers as I could. So thank you for going the extra mile with me. I really appreciate it. But you'll be able to go into the courtyard. You can exit when we end the service. And then come on back in if you want for the 11 o'clock for additional ministry. We have Pastor Geraldine and her beautiful daughter, Grace Baliano, at the 11 o'clock service. And tonight we're going to get to hear from Pastor Sarah and myself at 6 o'clock service. So until then, go in the blessing and the peace of Almighty God. I love you all. Thank you for being online. Shalom. We'll see you at the next service if you can join us. God bless you.